you by McDonald's. McDonald's, I'm loving it. Well, he started three games this year. He gives them a little bit of scoring punch down low. He's got a little size, and they'll need him against a great player in Derek Williams.
You got to put some size out there on the floor. Arizona's physical. They are big. So you got to do whatever you can to match up and hope things work out.
Sean Miller coaching the Arizona Wildcats, and boy, all signs point to a program on the rise. A great job so far by Sean Miller.
Well, what he's done, he's done a great job of putting his fingerprint on this program as far as the demands he sets on the players and his attention to detail. And it's starting to rub off, and you're starting to see that in how Arizona plays.
And Dane Altman, a very successful career at Creighton University in Omaha, Nebraska. And the Pac-10 season is underway. And the Wildcats control the tip. Perry in the starting lineup again after that great performance against Robert Morris the other night. Also played well in that road game in NC State, didn't he?
Played very well. Worked his way into that starting lineup and really worked, in, like I said, worked his way in and would not be denied. Coach Miller recognizing that effort.
There's Perry in the corner. Ducks will extend their zone a little bit on the defensive side. Arizona with their first possession here. The arena still filling up. No students on campus. Jones the long three at the buzzer on the shot clock, and Arizona will get a second chance here. Jones to the basket, and he finger rolls it in.
And that's 2 points that should not have happened. They forced Arizona down to 2 seconds left on the clock. They shoot, miss, and get the second shot. They're going to have to eliminate those when you play in that zone defense.
Ducks generally have done a pretty good job rebounding the ball. Here's Catron. He can't get it to fall. And a rebound for the Wildcats. Ducks will press after made baskets. That's a trademark of Dane Altman teams. Arizona worked on it a lot today at the shoot-around, breaking that press. Solomon Hill is cut off. Perry. Jones down to 10 on the shot clock. Down low on the block, and four quick ones for Arizona on their first two possessions.
Great penetration, great assist. Solomon Hill with nice body control up and off the glass.
E.J. Singler with the ball now. Perry all over him. E.J.'s been a consistent player for Oregon. Here's Catron down low. E.J.'s been in double figures 10 out of the 12 games. Armstead for three. Not there. Catron. And now Jonathan Lloyd will have the ball. There's a new shot clock, and he goes up and fouled and is scored. So Catron with a big early basket for Oregon.
Very strong move by Catron. He had one roll in and out. He had it on the block and really didn't like the feel of it. But that time, he made up his mind to just put the ball on the deck, go strong to the hole, and got the contact.
And the foul is on Derek Williams. So that's his first foul, of course. And again, for those of you just joining us, a joint broadcast tonight between Oregon and Arizona here on the holiday. Happy that we were able to bring it to you. This game not originally scheduled to be televised, so we worked together with our IMG partners to get it on, and that's why Corey's joining me tonight. And a big tip of the cap to Dave Sitton, one of the legends in the business.
Definitely. Glad to be here.
Arizona with a 4-2 lead here early as Jones goes in, and there's that penetration you talked about. Opens up the three-pointer, and Solomon Hill knocks it down.
Very strong start for Arizona. You get the two inside layups. Now you come back with a three-pointer. You've got to find solutions in that zone for that.
See if they shoot Oregon out of that zone. They certainly have the capability of doing it. Then the Ducks will go back and forth between man-to-man and zone defense. Armstead, a little offensive push-off. And Michael Irvin gives him the call and sends it the other way.
I don't know about that call. When you put the ball on the wood and you start to go, any kind of contact you draw while the defender's on the move, that's usually blocking foul.
Here's our U.S. Bank fast start to success tonight, Corey.
And for Arizona, they got to think green. They need to attack in the paint and get as many inside buckets as they can. And it's all about risk versus reward. Here you see Oregon in that zone trying to be a little risky. You've got to make a pay when they go to that pressure defense.
Perry works hard after the block, gets a rebound, and should be considered a rebound, and also a basket after the initial block. And now Arizona leads 9-2 here early. A great start for Arizona. They've scored every time down the floor. And then a foul called underneath on Perry, who's working against Tyrone Nairn. Here's what Oregon needs to do here at the bottom of the train here.
Oregon's got to set that trap, that 1-3-1 they just had. They got to create some turnovers, use that pressure defense, and they got to be one and done. Arizona gets one shot, and that's it. They can't give up the second and third shot. It's hard to rebound out of that zone, but they're going to have to do it tonight against this Arizona team.
Sean Miller goes to Nachetko into the game. He's matched up against Jovan Catron. There you see it right there. Catron, a strong move. Comes up short. Gets a rebound, though. They've gotten the ball down to Catron. He's had to finish except for the one play,
which is good for him early. He's being very active and aggressive. Just got to get the ball to roll his way a little bit.
Singler for the three in rhythm. That's way too hard. And Perry has the rebound. Comes Jones. He'll pull up for the 15-footer and knock it down. So Arizona, could it get any better to start the Pac-10 season? When you score every time you have the ball, it's pretty tough to be behind, isn't it?
It's really tough, and they've had some great looks. They had to miss three, and what you don't want is what just happened. Three on two, absolutely no defensive pressure, nobody stops the ball, and Momo Jones goes up for an easy 15-footer. That's playground. He can do that all day long. Like we said earlier, if they're taking the ball out of bounds, then they can't run. So Oregon's got to knock down shots.
71% from the field for Arizona. And you see the very intense Sean Miller. We talked about it in our pregame show, which was seen on the Oregon affiliates of the game. But Sean Miller and Dana Altman had some games together when Dana was at Creighton and Sean Miller was at Xavier. Some good battles between those two coaches of that mid-major.
Always interesting to see the coaching styles. When you've coached against someone or you know of them, you watch the film, you watch their tendencies, and you prepare your team to beat his team. And it's interesting watching the chess match play out tonight.
Of course, Dana Altman inherits a much different team than I think Arizona fans are used to seeing. This is a relatively young team. There's lots of new faces. There was some attrition after the Ernie Kent dismissal. And you see, you know, Tyrone Nairn. Malcolm Austin was here last year. E.J. Singler, but when they get into the bench with J.R. Strobridge, Jonathan Lloyd, new players, Martin Zeifert, Garrett Sim, ball gets knocked away and out of bounds. And that will bring us to our first media timeout here at MacArthur Court. 15-42 in the first half. Arizona out to a hot start. They lead it 11-2.
I got it. Let's celebrate.
All right.
McDonald's?
Whoa, whoa. 10-2, buddy. Hands on the wheel. Eyes on the road, right? So this is what it's like to be driven around, huh?
I'll look over there, honey.
What?
The Broncos finished the addition on their house.
Oh, yeah. Mm.
The want it, need it.
Stay focused.
Gotta have a taste of the Quarter Pounder with Cheese, Big Mac, and Angus Third Pounder.
Hey, hop on the expressway.
But it's rush hour.
The simple joy worth waiting for.
How's your burger, bro?
Beginning January 4th on Comcast Sportsnet, we're getting ready for the National Championship Game. And we're talking Ducks. Live every night at 9, Talking Ducks brings you guest panelists and special features with Coach Eliotti, Darren Thomas, and Kenyon Barner. Oregon Sports Hall of Famer Dwight James brings you nightly reports from Glendale, along with an exclusive interview with head coach Chip Kelly. Talking Ducks, presented by Les Schwann, live beginning January 4th on Comcast Sportsnet.
These kids almost had a new community center. A contractor almost volunteered to build it. A carpenter almost worked on the crew. And everyone else almost gave at the fundraiser. They almost gave. Almost. And these kids? Well, they almost stayed out of trouble.
Comes out firing, huh? Like they've shot in this gym a few times before.
Well, they definitely are getting the looks. There you see interior getting into the paint area. Momo Jones, unchallenged layup from point blank. He's going to knock that down. And then they got it working from the outside with Solomon Hill. That zone has holes. It's up to the offense to find it. And here's just open court. No defense, 3-on-2. That's a fast break drill in practice. Both teams work on that stuff.
11-2 is the score, and Arizona, as we've mentioned, has scored every time they've been down on the offensive end. A couple of offensive rebounds have helped them there. Ducks need to get something going here early in this second-to-last game ever at MacArthur Court. Catron cans the three, and they needed it, didn't they, Corey?
They needed that in a big way. It allows them to set their pressure defense. It breaks that drought and gives them a little bit of energy, and there's the turnover.
Oh! And a blocking foul as Armstead goes up. He couldn't believe he didn't make the shot. He thought it went in. I think a little bit too far under the basket.
A little bit too far under the basket. And there you see the big fella who's not necessarily known for his shooting, knocking down that three. You've got to get a hand up out there, and you can't assume he's not going to shoot that. He's the most assertive, most aggressive player they've got right now.
Got to get some oil on those reels, you know.
Yeah.
Armstead not able to get the free throw, but they got what they wanted with the three-pointer, and then pick up a foul on the way to the basket, and Armstead with the steal on the press. That's how they make their hay.
Exactly, and I like what Coach Altman's doing. You know, we score, we mess up the tempo for you. You made some threes, you made some easy layups. We're going to change the tempo of the game, see if you can get the ball over half court.
Armstead not able to capitalize on that turnover on the shot and the free throw. 6-point lead for Arizona. Just underway here in Eugene. Very cold day outside. A little snow yesterday. But the ball on the sideline is Kevin Herron. Just got a little too far underneath.
Too far underneath, and Oregon slipping back into that man-to-man coverage that time. Arizona not really shaking up, going right to their offense. But last two Arizona possessions, two turnovers.
Jonathan Lloyd from Las Vegas, Nevada here for Oregon. Every year, Oregon seems to come out with another 5'8 point guard, don't they?
They find them.
Last year it was Tawan Porter. Now Jonathan Lloyd has played really well so far this year. Down to Jeremy Jacob. He posts it up. Can't get it to fall.
Plenty of good opportunities for Oregon.
Horn is in the game now. Back to
Perrin.
Nice two-man game.
He's
off
with
a three.
Kevin Perrin is so smooth and so cool. Great penetration by Jamel Horn in the kick. A lot of that going on tonight. Penetrating and kicking on both teams.
Leads back to nine. Jacob. Lloyd for three. It's too hard. The shooting woes continue. For Arizona. On fire.
Hand down, man down. Singler got to get that hand up. This is Division I college basketball. You can't just come out with your hands down. Kevin Parham knocked down his first. You already know as a shooter, if you've got the first one and you get a chance to knock down the second one, there you see he's out there but not close enough. And Kevin Parham says, I'll take that. Thank you very much.
17-5 start.
And if
well, folks, Oregon Duck basketball is presented in high definition by the Ron Tonkin family of dealerships. Ron Tonkin for the love of cars. Ducks down 17-5. Need to get something going here, Corey. They had a little moment there, didn't they? But not sustained.
You know, they really got to get some good looks over the next couple of possessions. Down 12. You don't want it to get to 20. You want to shore this up and get this back to single digits.
Tyrone Nairn. Arizona tracking man-to-man right now. Jacob goes up and hits.
Yeah, really nice shot, and they need to do that more. It's not like Derek Williams is going to get in foul trouble defensively, so I would attack that option.
Jordan Mays is in the game, and he fires away. And front iron. J.R. Strobridge in for Oregon after that timeout. Jacob takes it down low. And a foul by Naren on the rebound. And you're right, Corey, they're getting good looks. Not hitting them.
They're not hitting them. They're getting the same looks Arizona's getting at the other end. The penetration, but here you see the one-on-one just raise up and shoot it. Derek Williams not really going to challenge that too much. I mean, you're 8 or 9 feet away from the basket. But you're absolutely right, Joe. Oregon's had great looks. They just haven't been able to knock them down. They're getting the same penetration kicks, the same inside-out plays Arizona's been benefiting from.
3 of 10 from the field now for Oregon. And Strobridge on Lavender, young man from Mesa, Arizona. Now Horn with it. That's the other thing about Arizona, this Paragos baseline is their depth. They'll play a lot of guys, and they all can play. Lloyd takes it coast to coast and lays it in.
Great possession for Oregon. The zone finally pays off. Arizona misses its second three in a row, and you're able to get the ball down the floor before the defense even sets up.
Parham open for three. He hits it.
Kevin Parham is on fire, and they are doing a great job of finding him.
Arizona with the lead. Strobridge trying to answer. Short. Arizona on a little bit of a break here. Horn takes it in, and they'll get him on an offensive foul. I think maybe they thought his shoulder dipped down just a little bit. Still a great start for Arizona with 11:33 to go. They've got a 20-9 lead.
I'm out on the floor. The season was 1926-27.
Hey, man, how's my truck doing?
Good. They're just changing the oil.
We're in.
Here we go.
Come on, y'all.
I'm gonna go check on the fellas.
You guys almost done?
It's gonna take a while. You're leaking diesel fuel.
It's not a diesel engine.
Yeah, that's why it's so bad.
It's the sure sign of a good time. The just right taste of Bud Light. Here we go.
If you've stopped saving, let us help you start. Savings today and rewards tomorrow from U.S. Bank. Save a little every week with every purchase, every paycheck. Watch your savings grow. When you reach $1,000, you'll earn a $50 rewards Visa card. Earn another $50 when you keep it for a year. Save for a wedding day, a family, or your house. Just start. All of us serving you. U.S. Bank.
American Family Insurance created a special policy called the She Has the Perfect Place. It's going to be a perfect evening. And tonight, in a most unexpected place, she will meet the perfect guy. Policy. Emergency Road Service is one of over 375 products and features we use to create your custom family protection. Is your coverage as unique as your family?
American Family Insurance.
MacArthur Court in Eugene, everyone. We just want to wish all of you out there, all around the country, watching everywhere, really, a very happy holiday season from Oregon and Arizona Athletics as we produce this game jointly today. And Rob Mullins, the athletic director at Oregon, and somebody with some Oregon ties, Greg Burns, doing a great job at Arizona. We're all really excited about the job that Greg Burns is going to do at Arizona, and all the great things happening at both universities who share a lot of commonality and a lot of successes as well over the years, and have been able to rise in this incredible league with the USC's of the world, the UCLA's, and you know, these big metropolitan areas like Washington and Arizona State. A lot of great success with these two schools.
Absolutely. Great tradition, coaching staffs, athletic programs, and facilities as well.
Katron hard to the basket. And it's going to go the other way, and Katron's slow to get up.
Great physical move right there by Katron. He's very aggressive. He can get to the basket anytime he wants to. There's really nothing Arizona can do about it. He's just got to know when to slam on the brakes and not pick up the charge.
Let's go over to Jill Savage real quick, Jill.
Thanks, Joe. I just heard Coach Altman tell his team in the huddle that they need to start contesting the three-point shots, that if they start doing that, then they're going to have a shot in this game. But without that, they're already off to a big lead here. Joe, back to you.
Ducks get another steal and don't convert again. Here comes Arizona. They're 4 of 7 from three-point range. Arum already has 9 in the game. Here's Hill. Every time Arizona brings a player off the bench, he's a great player. There's no drop-off.
They've been very good at getting talented players who are, for the most part, interchangeable. There's so many different weapons. And Coach Miller's done a great job of breaking up the minutes and keeping everybody's confidence level high. So when they do come in, they've got a rhythm that they've already established.
They do have 20 points, also 5 turnovers so far, and Armstead can't hit. Ducks now 4 of 14 from the field. Perry, a strong move. Comes up a little short. Fights for the rebound. And then gets fouled. Good hard work.
And this is what we talked about, Joe. Being a little bit undersized, you can't give up that second shot. There's Perry. He misses. The ball gets tipped, and he's back up off the floor fighting for it around 4 white shirts and ends up getting fouled. If you grab that first rebound, you're off to the races, cutting into the lead instead of standing there while he shoots 2 free throws.
So he'll go to the line for Arizona's first free throw attempt of the night. So, a little bit to the right. That's another statement, a little bit.
Yeah, you were very kind.
You see those Oregon uniforms they're wearing tonight? These are the throwback uniforms that they've been wearing here at Mack Court as the building is closed to commemorate the 1939 national champions. Oregon won the very first NCAA championship in 1939, and these are the uniforms they wore. There's one big difference, I got to think, and that's the shorts, right? They're not really tighties.
Well, the shorts would be a lot more tight, and I doubt Nike was around then. So the Nike swoosh is not exactly historically accurate.
That is correct. Nothing like the old short shorts of the archived basketball footage of the day. I don't think they're ever coming back.
No.
And good riddance.
That's a health concern nowadays. You can't do that.
Here's Jonathan Lloyd. Armstead. Back over to Garrett Sim. Ducks are down to 10 on the shot clock. Down to 5. E.J. Singler with nowhere to go. 2. Sim throws up a prayer and it gets rimmed. And the Cats with a good defensive possession.
A lot of penetration, but nobody's willing to take that extra step and go ahead and shoot. When you penetrate, you got to get the ball up to the rim, just like Derek Williams did just there. They had situations where they beat their defender, but they stopped, picked it up, and gave it to someone else, where Derek Williams, he's not going to give it to anybody else. He's going to put it up.
He's been real patient in the game, too. We're halfway through the first half, and I think the sign of a good player. I know, you know, all the Arizona fans and Oregon fans know all about Luke Jackson, and he was the same way. You know, Luke can float along in a game with no points for 10 minutes, but he was very patient. As the game started to play out and defenses started to not quite focus on him as much, then he pounced. And that's when he got his numbers, and that's a little bit like Derek Williams.
Well, you know, you say you let the game come to you. I think the difference between the elite players and the regular players, you let the game come to you all the while intending to insert yourself into it at some point. You don't just go out there and see what happens. You pick your spots, and that's what both Luke and Derek do very well.
Sims passes up underneath, and he gives it out to Singler for 3. They just cannot hit the basket right now. Reminiscent of the Idaho game. Singler again. Another chance. And Arizona comes out with it. Up in the air, and it's a little bit short for Williams. You saw it coming, Corey, but they didn't execute it.
I thought it was showtime, and it was no time. Momo Jones and Derek Williams have probably done that 50 times so far this season. They do it 100 times in practice, but just not a great lob and not a great finish there.
Made it tough on Williams to kind of have to go underneath the basket and left hand on it on a shorty. Alligator armed it. Ducks have no field goals in the last 3-plus minutes of play here, and they've fallen behind by 14 now. Jeremy Jacob, which seems to be their best option. And he scores again.
It's been a while since they heard from him. They need to go back to him. He's 2 for 2 with a nice mid-range jumper, and he's confident right now.
He's got four. Ducks still in that man-to-man. And they're going to call an offensive foul on a clear out. Bobby McCroy saw something that was not visible from the broadcast table.
Well, here you see Jacob, same thing. It's like instant replay, face-up bucket. Nobody up there contesting. He's a very solid player on the block and has been productive so far. I think they might want to stick with that. And at the other end, Solomon Hill, he got a mismatch on a smaller guard, and he was doing a little too much positioning, the referee felt.
That's the first foul on Solomon Hill. Another whistle on the other end, and, interesting how that works.
Well, what you're seeing right now is the officials trying to teach on the job as far as how to set screens, what are legal screens, what are illegal screens. You know, you can't just be moving when you run into somebody. And the referees with a tight whistle here early.
Matyechko is back in the game for Arizona. Gives them a nice size presence underneath. And Momo, a little bit short. Armstead. Jacob on a full head of steam, and he goes down hard, and he'll take the block foul and go to the line. And this is one thing I think the NCAA should look at, is instituting what the NBA does with the dotted line underneath, and it would really help define, I think, the game in the college area and really eliminate problems like this.
They certainly need to define it with just paint the arc down there so that you have the visual to follow the rule. All the coaches know the rule. You teach your players the rule. Get in position, take the contact, draw the charge. But they have no idea on the court where that happened. So they've got to go ahead and illustrate that so that the players can carry out what they're being taught.
I think it really helps the officials, too, in the NBA. Hey, if you block somebody in that arc, it's a foul on you, no matter what. And so, you know, really encouraging some offense in the game.
Absolutely, Joe. And, you know, the other thing is prevents a lot of unnecessary injury. You know, you don't want to have the big bodies flying around, guys coming down twisting ankles because the guy blocks your path. I mean, if you've got a layup and you're under the rim, you know, you really can't be there. So it would open up and space the game a little.
Jacob now has six. The Ducks have cut it down to 10. 8:07 to go here in the first half in Eugene. No students here, but a good crowd for the second to last game ever here at MacArthur Court. Nice play, huh? Off the glass.
That's what you have to do against the press. You have to get back and you have to score before they get to set that zone.
Ducks beat him back down on the floor, but Armstead again could not finish. Look at Hill go hard to the basket, and Perry's it for the rebound.
Jesse Perry's the garbage man. He lives in the lane. He's got a lot of putbacks. Solomon Hill with a strong take there. Everybody rotates over, leaves Perry alone on the glass.
Perry doesn't have the same size, but he's got that AC Green type of play. He likes to pick up the extra rebound. He works hard under the basket, a little bit like AC.
Definitely.
And there's Keandre Williams with a reverse lay-in.
Good to see some players stepping up for Oregon, being aggressive. The outside shot's not falling. They need to take it to the rim.
Arizona will use a timeout here with a 12-point lead, 7:15 to go here in the first half play. I think the big story so far, Corey, is just the shooting percentage. They have not been able to, Oregon has not been able to hit from the outside, and Arizona's been very good, shooting 56%.
Well, it's not like they have a hand in their face on every shot. Oregon's done a great job of finding each other, but here they let the shot clock wind down and got to just heave one up. But they've had several looks where Arizona's just blown the coverage, and they've had dead-on looks and weren't able to knock it down. If you can't knock down shots on your home court, you know, it's going to be very difficult on the road in hostile environments. So this is as good as it's going to get as far as open shots is concerned.
The other big thing is Arizona's got a 15-8 rebounding edge. Now, a lot of those are offensive rebounds, Corey. When they do miss, as infrequent as that has been, they're getting second chances, too.
And that's what's killing Oregon. The fact that when you miss a shot and you're in a zone defense, you don't have a man to box out, so you're just hoping the ball bounces your way and you're able to get it. Arizona's sending two, sometimes three players to the offensive glass.
Arizona moving the ball. Fogup comes up for the 20-footer and hits it just inside the three-point line, and Kyle Fogg has the basket. Arizona spreading the wealth around. They lead it by 14. Naren. Boy, that's good defense right there. by Kyle Fogg. He caused trouble on the perimeter and then forced the turnover on the outside. And that will bring us to another timeout with 6:48 to go from Eugene. Arizona leads it by 14.
Why would someone switch to a different auto insurance company?
Me, I wanted to save money, and I did with Amica.
Call 877-52-AMICA now and find out why you should make the change.
I was actually with another company, but I got into this accident with one of Amica's customers, and they were so nice at Amica that I said, that's it. That's what I want.
We hear that a lot.
I switched because I did a bunch of research on who was winning awards for great service and getting the best ratings from consumers, and guess which name kept coming up?
Amica.
Saving money's great, but I got so much more when I called Amica.
Call Amica now and ask about all the different options we have to offer, like accident forgiveness, new car replacement, identity fraud protection, and discounts on getting auto and home insurance together.
More options, more savings. That's why I picked Amica.
And with our driver rewards program, you'll start earning points as soon as you become an Amica customer. Those points can help you save on deductibles and more.
So call Amica.
Tonight's game is brought to you by American Family Insurance. Visit AmFam.com or call American Family Insurance. Visit AmFam.com or call 1-800-MY-AMFAM today. By the NeuroSpine Institute, surgical specialists of the spine. And by U.S. Bank. They're proud to support Oregon men's basketball. Well, those of you around the country on Comcast Sportsnet South or FCS Atlantic or in Arizona on the WB station there, and also on K-Gun, my good friend Dave Silver, one of the true gems of all of sportscasting, great citizen of Tucson. If there's an award in Tucson for first citizen, Dave Silver should win it.
Dave Silver and Dave Sitton as well.
Yeah.
YMG.
I mean, that's a pretty tough, you know, I mean, Dave Sitton, of course, with as long time as he's been there and all the activity he does, what a legend in the market, and lots of great people in Tucson, Arizona. My sister went to Arizona. My brother-in-law played baseball and football for the Arizona Wildcats and made it to the San Diego Padres. His name is Kevin Ward. Some of awesome. You Arizona fans will remember that name, a family member of mine. So I really like the Cats and have had it in my family. Spent a lot of time down there. Love Tucson.
Can't beat the Tucson winners.
I thought a little bit, although I heard it snowed a little bit around Tucson today.
Yeah,
is that true?
They went a little crazy down there today. Got some snow. They didn't know what to do.
That was here yesterday. Got down to Tucson in a hurry. Arizona up 29-15 with 6:36 to go here in the half. Getting anything they want right now. Parham goes into double figures with 11.
You know, Coach Altman going to that trap. He trapped the first pass, and Arizona handled the pressure and found somebody all alone under the basket.
Kevin's 4-of-4 as well. Then they get it down low again, and Katron scores.
If Oregon would stick to their interior game, they could claw their way back into this. They're only down 14, but they've got to find guys in the paint. They've been very successful at that.
Ducks fought back from a big deficit against Missouri earlier this year. They were down by 24 in that game, Corey, and they fought all the way back and had a three to tie it at the end and just couldn't get it. Jonathan Lloyd took that three, and he misses here as well. And Arizona wants another timeout. So Sean Miller did not like something, and he sends Solomon Hill into the game. Not sure for who yet, but he wasn't happy about something, was he?
Definitely. It's all about discipline, taking the shots that are good shots for the team. And that's exactly what Kevin Parham's been doing for Arizona. He hasn't been forcing everything, but there you see the penetration and the kick. That's the shot Sean Miller wants to see. He doesn't want to see the one-on-one takes. He doesn't want to see the one-on-one penetration dribbles. Penetrate, find your teammate, and knock it down. And nobody's been doing that better than Kevin Parham.
He's the only man in double figures in the game so far with 11. Pretty good line, 4-of-4 from the field, 3-of-3 from the line, a couple of rebounds. You know, they do all that is, you know, that Derek Williams only has 2 points. Again, he's doing what he needs to do. Parham's doing everything right now. And, you know, my sense is that as the game goes along, the big fella's going to get his point.
Well, you know, Derek Williams is kind of like Clark Kent. You know, I'll be there when you need me. If you don't need me, I'll stay with the glasses and the suit. But the cape could come out in the second half if Oregon tightens this game.
The whistle was about the shot clock. It just wouldn't be a game at MacArthur Court in Eugene without some sort of mechanical court function that was created 30 years ago.
It must be a virus. You know, the games in Tucson, Arizona, have had several games where they've had shot clock problems. I say go back to the old flip manual clocks. Yeah, stopwatch and flipboard.
Strowbridge chasing Hill. No horn, it's down to Williams. Mays in the game. Arizona moving the ball really well. They just don't get the shot to go down. A little extracurricular as just both guys fighting for the rebound. That's all that was.
Getting a little tangled up, but great ball movement by Arizona. They end up with Jamel Horn shooting a three. He's very capable of shooting a three. Just didn't knock it down, but more importantly, a good stop for the Ducks. They were able to secure the rebound and get to the free throw line, and they call it free throws. They're free.
Well, they are free. Let's see if Oregon can make it. You can see we sit here right in front of the student section at MacArthur Court. So some of that yelling you're hearing are mostly the students who live in the Eugene-Springfield area, because most of them are out of town. They're home in Portland and San Francisco and Denver throughout the West.
I can only imagine what it'd be like with a full house.
Well, I know that when Robbie Kloss and I do these games and it gets going, you bounce the whole game. You don't ever sit. You have to get used to calling the game while you're bouncing up and down. One of them's good, 31-18, 5:02 to go.
And you know, Joe, that's one of the things that the professional game will never have on college athletics, the student body factor. It is so awesome in basketball and football to see your peers, your classmates come out and create an environment that can motivate a team. It just doesn't happen in a professional game at all.
That's one of the big things about the new Matthew Knight Arena, as Williams is fouled as he goes up. But the new Matthew Knight Arena, Corey, has the students right on the floor, the same spot. They're right here on the floor. Now it'll be a little bit different. There are two rows of floor-level seating, and this is a very high-end arena. And so those of you who have been to the Galen Center have seen that. This cost more than $100 million more than the Galen Center. So it gives you an idea of the scale of the building and the size of it. But it's also very, it feels very collegial. It's very close to the action. It's very, very steep, a little bit like you've seen at Cal, at the new arena in California that they built there at Hospital Williams.
I have to admire that. Build the state-of-the-art arena, but keep the students close. A lot of ADs and programs would sell those high-dollar seats for good money, but keeping that college atmosphere is very important here at Oregon.
Through the years, it's been less and less. Back in the day, when you were playing, Corey, the students were all around the floor all the way. The only place they weren't were right behind the bench. They were in both end zones, and that had changed a little bit as well through the years. Mays, a strong move, but he's rejected by E.J. Single. Sim backs it out. This is what they've had. Jacob. Strowbridge, 20 on the shot clock. Jonathan Lloyd. Arizona played really good defense on this possession. It's down to 10. Sim comes out. Contested shot, and he hits it. Maybe that's what he needs.
Tough shot. Defender Kevin Parham hanging all over him. Sims with a great look. Fadeaway. If you're Coach Miller, you can't really be upset about that. He had a hand up, but just a great effort by Sim.
3:27 to go in the half. Arizona with a 13-point lead. See the shooting in the game. We're going to get an offensive foul on the push-off. We called Derek Williams getting his left arm out there a little bit. Or excuse me, that was Jamel Horn on the dribble drive. That's two fouls on Horn, 3:12 to go. We'll come back right after this.
Hey, everyone's eating tacos outside Bill's office.
Don't you think that's some information I would like to know? I like tacos.
You invited Eric? I thought Eric gave you the creeps. Oh. Yeah.
Hey. Don't be left behind. Get it first with AT&T, the nation's fastest mobile broadband network, period. Rethink possible.
With Bi-Mart's Owner's Choice special pricing, you can save more time and spend less money. Owner's Choice is Bi-Mart's way of giving you deeper discounts for an extended time on the things you use for everyday living. You'll find exceptional savings on the items you want and need. You can count on constant savings without having to shop around. In every department, Owner's Choice values will help you save time and money. Saving more and getting more, it's a beautiful thing. It's Owner's Choice values at Bi-Mart, just right for the Northwest.
If your back won't let you go back to doing the simple things you love, remember, you can always turn to the people of the Neurospine Institute. We're here to help you leave your back problems behind you. The Neurospine Institute, surgical specialists of the spine.
.312 to go. Arizona leads it 33-20.
Wildcat fans, are you looking for tickets? Order your tickets for any Arizona home athletics event through the McHale Ticket Office. Tickets can be ordered online at ArizonaWildcats.com or by phone at 520-621-2287 or in person at the McHale Ticket Office Monday through Friday, 9 to 5.
Should be a hot ticket this year as this program is definitely on the rise and was my pick to win the league. I just have an inability to pick Washington to win the league. I think for a lot of Arizona fans, you know, that Oregon-Washington rivalry is probably the biggest non-traditional rivalry in the conference.
Definitely.
And my pick is Arizona. I think they have the depth to win the league, Corey. They bring guys off the bench. They've got high-end players and talent. Derek Williams, great hard workers, a great young coach. And I really like them.
It is a long season, and if you can go 11 deep, it does help you. These guys have all been there before. This is a group of sophomores predominantly who've played here. They've got a game under their belt. There's no surprises. They know how long the season is. Washington has a lot more experience in this Arizona club. However, I don't think they're as deep. So you make a great point. It'll be a game to mark on your calendar for sure.
Yeah, I think there will be times during the year that Washington will, you know, get into some foul trouble, or if you have one or two guys that are not hitting on that night or your percentage drops a little bit, then you don't have anybody to go to. For Arizona, it drops off. You just bring in another guy, and then he, you know, chance for him to be hot just because of their depth.
You know, I played small forward throughout college and professionally, and I've never at the collegiate level seen a team be carried by guards and be that successful. You've got to have some good inside play to accompany that. I don't know if the guard tandem in Washington can bring home a Pac-10 title just with the two of those guys leading the way. They're definitely going to need a balanced attack.
Tyrone Nairn not there. You know, the other team that I am really surprised about is USC and the way they're playing. This Parham goes up. I think it's his first miss of the game. It is. Armstead. Here's J.R. Strobridge back to Garrett Sim. He takes it in the lane and lays it up and can't finish again. Ducks just have gotten to the rim. They just can't get it down the basket.
And Coach Miller not exactly thrilled with Kevin Parham's last shot. You've got a 15-point edge last 3 minutes. You want to go in up 20. You don't want this to get whittled away to be in a 10-point or single-digit game. So shot selection, very important for Arizona.
A three-second call on, I believe it was on Derek Williams standing in the lane, wasn't it? Call it on somebody in the lane. It was on Derek Williams, 3 seconds in the key. And USC, with what they did winning at Tennessee, that's a big win. And then also almost beating Kansas down to the final minute against Kansas. And certainly you know how good Kansas is, and Arizona fans do as well.
And, you know, I have to say, that Kansas team, I'm not exactly sold on them as being good, as good as advertised. USC was a nail-biter. UCLA was a nail-biter. Arizona was in it until they called a ghost foul on Derek Williams. I think it's a credit to the Pac-10 teams, but also I don't believe Kansas is that solid from start to finish. But that's just me.
Yeah. Well, the tough part about this is the way the RPI works in college basketball, where teams actually start with a number, which is crazy. I don't know how you don't start everybody at zero. And now in the league, teams in the Pac-10 are not going to be able to climb their RPIs because there's so many teams in the league that have such low RPIs. Oregon is nearly 200. Oregon State was like 245 in the RPI.
I agree with you completely. To assign a team an arbitrary number before they've even dribbled one ball or made one shot, it just doesn't make any sense to me. I think that should be something that comes out perhaps now. After everybody's got 10 or 11 games in the book, you go ahead and give people ratings. But to say these teams are weak and they're going to stay weak is definitely not fair to the teams or our conference.
Under a minute, 35-20. Cats have been great inside, outside. A foul is called. I think they're going to get Narron on the call, not Singler, who actually blocked the shot.
Arizona's last four possessions, you've had some turnovers, some guys over-penetrating. Not as clean as it started off. Here you see Momo Jones on the penetration. He's really got nowhere to go, and they bail him out with, I don't really see the foul there, but you got Derek Williams at the top of the key, just kind of got bailed out there on that call.
Jones now with five in the game. Gives a look over to the students. I don't know if he was just, you know, trying to take in Matt Court for one final time. Not that he got any history with the building, but
not at all.
For these guys,
responding to the student section. You know, we used to say, don't pay attention to what's going on over the sidelines, because if you are, pretty soon you'll be over there with them. So just focus on the game. Don't worry about the student section. Knock your free throws down.
Gets them both. 17-point lead, 44 seconds here in this first half. Oregon just 8 of 27 from the field in the first half. Sim needs to get hot, too hard. 8 of 28 in the first half. Arizona going to hold for the final shot now. With a 17-point lead, and Oregon finds themselves very much in a game that's almost identical to the game against Missouri when they trailed big. And then did make a run, though, Corey, and came back in the second half.
Well, Joe, you know, the shots are there. They've just got to knock them down. They've done a great job of moving the ball, just not going their way so far.
Down to six, five. Gets knocked away. Ducks have a chance to get a basket. On the way, and lays up and in, and they count the basket. And so the Ducks cut the lead to 15 on a final steal and lay-in. But for the most part, it's a banner first half for Arizona. If you take out the final 5 seconds of the first half, out hot, great shooting by Parham. They've got a 15-point lead here as we go to the break in this second-to-last game at MacArthur Court in Eugene. This game should have been at the new Matthew Knight Arena, but the delays in construction pushed it here. Both these two teams trying to put on a show here tonight. Our halftime festivities coming up after this.
One morning, driving to work, my car started making this noise. I drove to a local service station, and they told me I needed new brakes. I decided to have Les Schwab do the work instead.
How can we help you today?
When my car was up on the lift, they noticed there was just a rock stuck in my left caliper, and my brakes still had about 80% left, saving me almost $300.
Be safe.
Thank you is not enough, but I hope it will do. I'm Cecily Fleury, and that's my Les Schwab story.
Les Schwab, doing the right thing since 1952.
You want to spend time on what really matters. When you shop, you want to talk with an expert you can trust. And what matters to you is going to one store and finding exactly what you need. Come to the one place that has it all. Standard TV and appliance. Expert salespeople, the best products, the largest selection, low prices, and of course, service you can depend on. Visit any of Standard's showrooms to find top name brand appliances, electronics, mattresses, and more. Standard TV and appliance.
Trailblazers Courtside, from the hardwood to the studio, will bring you the most in-depth Blazers coverage around.
The two shakalaka!
Taking phone calls, texts, and emails from players, coaches, critics, and fans.
It's the show where everyone has a chance to speak their mind.
Not to mention all the Blazers news and info you can handle.
There's Aldridge again, and he jams with two hands.
Trailblazers Courtside,
Monday on Comcast Sportsnet.
Coming up Sunday, it's a brand new edition of Rip City Live on Comcast Sportsnet. We'll talk with Blazers coaches and players, have a little fun with some behind-the-scenes features of your team, talk about the importance of the upcoming stretch of games, bring you the latest news on Brandon Roy, and break down the game with our insider analysts. So tune in and get the inside scoop before the Blazers-Rockets game with an all-new episode of Rip City Live.
Rip City, baby.
When smoking has taken your life, your teammates can replace you. But what will your family do?
Welcome back, everyone. That view of MacArthur Court from the third deck. This will be the last time it's ever seen live on television. And there's the Duck, very famously rising in popularity this year. As you can't turn on the TV, I know, without seeing the Duck this year. Here's a look at our Bi-Mart scoreboard report brought to you by our friends at Bi-Mart. Your employee-owned Bi-Mart, owner of choice pricing, just right for the Northwest. Villanova with a hard-fought win. Missouri over Old Dominion today. BYU, you saw BYU, they're pretty good, aren't they?
Very solid ball club, senior, heavy, play well together.
Oregon State, Arizona State just underway in Corvallis. They're about a half an hour behind us. And Gil Coliseum, alive tonight with Pac-10 basketball. We'll take a quick break. And Rob Mullins, the athletic director, coming up right after this.
If you've stopped saving, let us help you start. Savings today and rewards tomorrow from U.S. Bank. Save a little every week with every purchase, every paycheck. Watch your savings grow. When you reach $1,000, you'll earn a $50 rewards Visa card. Earn another $50 when you keep it for a year. Save for a wedding day, a family, or your house. Just start. All of us serving you. U.S. Bank.
Excuse me.
For change. It's nice to know you can trust people. State Farm is counting on it. They want you to talk to your neighbors, then call a State Farm agent, find out how you can get discounts up to 40%. See, State Farm insures 40 million drivers. That's more than Geico and Progressive combined. 40 million drivers, more savings, and discounts up to 40%. So call an agent at 1-800-STATE-FARM or go online.
It's a good feeling when you find something that's just right for you or for your family. As a Bi-Mart member, you know what that's like. For over 50 years, we've been bringing savings to Northwest families just like yours. Now more than ever, it's important to find the values your family needs. That's why Bi-Mart offers Owner's Choice Special Values and the chance to win free merchandise every week on Lucky Number Tuesdays. Today, tomorrow, and every day, Bi-Mart is just right for more values, more savings, and more advantages. Count on Bi-Mart, just right for the Northwest.
Pepsi Max, please.
Good song.
Great song.
So, Pepsi Max has zero calories, huh?
Yep.
How many calories?
Zero.
Zero?
Zero.
What are you doing?
YouTube.
Huh.
Pepsi Max. Zero calories. Maximum Pepsi taste.
He's got him down there, and he threw it, and he caught his touchdown. He is touchdown, Oregon. Ball came loose. Oregon's got him. They score. 10 through the corner. Touchdown, Oregon. That's a Jeff Bell touchdown. And fans everywhere, 114 years they've waited, and Oregon is going to play in the national championship game. Welcome back, everyone. High atop MacArthur Court, 37-22, Arizona out in front of this basketball game, this opener in the Pac-10 conference season. Arizona looking very good right now. And joined here at halftime by the Oregon Athletic Director, Rob Mullins, who has a very good friend down in Tucson, don't you?
That's right. Greg and I had a chance to work together previously in our careers, and Greg Byrne has a lot of ties to Eugene and the University of Oregon, had growing up here when his father was the AD.
Yeah, he sure does, and going to do a great job. It already is at Arizona. They have a lot of great things going on at Arizona. Certainly at Oregon, I mean, I don't know, is it all-time high? I've been around a little while. It's all-time excitement with Oregon headed to the championship football game.
Yeah, it certainly is all-time excitement with football, and we've got a lot going on here. The last couple of men's basketball games at MacArthur Court, then we open up brand new Matthew Knight Arena. So we're in a very intense period of excitement here.
Rob, first year here at MacArthur Court. Let's start there. This is quite a building. There are a lot of people here tonight that came to pay their respects, if you will.
Yeah, they sure did. You know, there's a lot of history here. This is one of the great all-time buildings, and it served the University of Oregon well for a number of years.
Of course, moving down the way here, about, I don't know, four blocks away to the new arena, the new Matthew Knight Arena, it is absolutely spectacular. I know you were in there today. The two practice gyms, you know, people don't realize the crunch just to get our teams to practice.
Yeah, with the number of teams we have, just trying to schedule the venue can be difficult. And what we have not only in the state-of-the-art basketball facility from an arena standpoint and what it can do for our basketball programs or volleyball programs, as well as for the community for outside events, but also, as you see, you know, there's so many great things, practice courts, locker rooms, that can really have an impact.
The exterior of the arena is spectacular. Inside the arena, as they make the final touches on the scoreboards, and then the floor, the unique Oregon floor that commemorates the tall firs, and people will know as soon as they turn the TV that it's Oregon playing a basketball game.
Yeah, there's so many things taken from MacArthur Court to Matthew Knight Arena to really respect the history and tradition of Oregon basketball, but then there's so many neat new things like the unique court that will certainly be part of our brand from here on out. The technology that's now in the building will really move us into the next century.
Of course, there's a little thing called a championship game coming up. You just got the golden touch.
Well,
in Eugene, new arena, close this one down, a lot of affinity, and then a national championship, an undefeated football team.
Yeah, certainly the Lucky Timing Award, and feel very fortunate to be here and be part of the excitement. There have been so many that have contributed so much to the foundation and the building process, and here we are under Chip Kelly's leadership getting ready to go to Phoenix and really play in, you know, one of the most visible things in collegiate sports.
Yeah, I think a lot about Rich Brooks and those years of fighting through it when there was nothing except a stadium that seated 40,000, there was 20 there. And then Mike Lotti and the foundation's there, and now Chip Kelly with a Rose Bowl back-to-back Pac-10 champions, an appearance in the national title game, and everything that goes along with that, all the notoriety, and not only for athletics, Rob, but also for the University of Oregon in general, as applications to the university are up more than 30%.
Yeah, it's fantastic. The visibility for the athletic program is wonderful, and then you add to that what all the attention brings to the campus and to the community. It's exactly what we want, and we're excited to be here. And, you know, there has been a long building process, but we're going to do everything we can to remain here as long as possible.
Well, we sure enjoyed having you very much. Thanks again. And I know Arizona's got a great, great outlook for their basketball team, and they look to be a team that can make a deep run into the NCAA tournament. Oregon certainly has a chance to win the national championship in football. These two universities, very much alike, sharing a lot of successes.
When we switched our car insurance to Amica, I knew right away we'd found something special. My wife called for a quote, and when she got off the phone, she said,
"Okay, I'm impressed. They explained everything."
When you call Amica, we'll take the extra time to ask questions, find out what you really need, and explain your options. Making sure you have the right coverage is just the beginning of a great customer experience.
So the next day, I tell this guy at work I'd switch to Amica, and he says,
"Great company. They found all these ways to help me save money."
You could save hundreds by switching to Amica, and you'll be choosing the company that's built a reputation for customer satisfaction and great customer service.
So about a year later, I got into an accident. When I got to the body shop, that guy told me,
"Oh, you're with Amica? Oh, they're the best. Oh yeah, they're really gonna take care of you."
So call Amica now and make the switch. You could save a lot of money on auto insurance. Call 877-98-AMICA.
You want something different? Something better? Call Amica.
That's right. It's a beefy crunch burrito. And yes, it's loaded with flaming hot Fritos chips because I don't like playing it safe. I'm a wild man, but also responsible because it's just 99 cents. So why don't you turn around one more time? I dare ya. Oh boy, now what? The new 99-cent Beefy Crunch Burrito. The crunch of flaming hot Fritos chips, seasoned beef, and nacho cheese sauce. All for just 99 cents at Taco Bell.
Is bringing you more Ducks coverage leading up to the national championship game than anywhere else. 88 hours more. We're also bringing you the most exclusive coverage around. Oregon Sports Hall of Famer Dwight James brings you exclusive interviews with head coach Chip Kelly and Nike co-founder Phil Knight. Special features with current players Darren Thomas, Kenyon Barner, and more. 88 hours of the most exclusive Ducks coverage around begins January 3rd on Comcast SportsNet.
Here we are back at MacArthur Court at halftime here in Eugene. It's a 37-22 lead for the Arizona Wildcats. Let's go in the training room for one of our tips from the trainer.
Plantar fasciitis is one of the more common foot injuries we see within the athletic world. Your plantar fascia is a piece of connective tissue that connects your heel bone to your toes. The symptoms of it are pain at that exact point. It's typically worse when you wake up first thing in the morning. The treatment of it is ice, a lot of stretching, both for the bottom of your foot. The best way to do that is take a tennis ball or a golf ball and roll your foot on it. In severe cases, people will oftentimes go and see a physician and be prescribed orthotics or put in a night splint, which is a splint that'll keep their foot in an upright position while they sleep.
That's our tips from the trainer, brought to you by our great friends at Regions. Time now for halftime highlights, brought to you by Oregon Community Credit Union. And you saw those stats there for a moment. We'll get to those in just a minute. You know, Corey, I think the start that Arizona had was really, that's the kind of start you want for your first game in Pac-10 play. I know you mentioned that you think that maybe Sean Miller's getting after him a little bit in the locker room. It's still a great start.
It's a great start, and you want to build on that. Arizona found early success inside and outside. They didn't struggle against the zone, which they had. And Oregon found great success early going inside, playing aggressive. But the story in the first half has been Kevin Parham dropping bombs from three. He's gotten Arizona out there comfortably, but Oregon having trouble shooting outside, having some success inside, maybe needs to start off in the second half looking inside.
Parham has 11 in the game, is the only man in double figures. Now let's look at those stats brought to you by Bud Light here at halftime, and the field goal percentage for Oregon. Again, that's the number, 9 out of 31, Corey, and you just can't win games, you know, at 30, less than 30%. You have to get it done.
Great point, Joe. I know school's out, but this is a math problem right here. If they're shooting 50 and you're shooting 20, they're going to win every time.
Second half here at the Pit coming up.
Hey, Duck fans, since 1894, the rivalry between Oregon State and Oregon has grown to a fever pitch. The 2010 Silver Series is in full force, and the action this year between the Ducks and the Beavers will be memorable. Year after year, the student athletes, coaches, and schools take great pride in being part of one of the longest rivalry series in the nation. The Civil War Series encompasses 10 sports, where the Ducks and Beavers go head-to-head. The University of Oregon would like to thank Pacific Source Health Plans as being a proud partner of the Civil War Series.
I got it. Let's celebrate.
All right.
McDonald's?
Whoa, whoa. 10 and 2, buddy. Hands on the wheel. Eyes on the road, right? So this is what it's like to be driven around, huh?
Oh, look over there, honey. The Frankels finished the addition on their house.
Oh, yeah. Mm.
The want it, need it.
Stay focused.
Gotta have a taste of the Quarter Pounder with Cheese, Big Mac, and Angus Third Pounder.
Hey, hop on the expressway.
But it's rush hour.
The simple joy worth waiting for.
How's your burger, bro?
Enrich our lives, make us smile, and complete our families. And when animals and their people need help, Animal Aid is there. Since 1969, Animal Aid has provided a safe haven for homeless animals and financial aid for urgent veterinary care. Contribute and be part of the Animal Aid legacy. Donate, volunteer, adopt, foster. You can make a difference. Visit animalaidpdx.org for more information.
Trailblazers coverage. Don't miss Talkin' Ball after every game on Comcast Sportsnet, featuring Ian Furness, Dwight James, and a special guest for every show, past Blazers, former NBA and college stars. You just never know who might show up. Make sure to catch Talkin' Ball, presented by the new Ram Outdoorsman, after every Blazers game on Comcast Sportsnet.
Yes. Welcome back, everyone, here to MacArthur Court. Just ready to start the second half. Ducks will start with the basketball. Big surprise out there tonight, and pretty good for the conference. How about that? The UConn women, the streak is over. Stanford beats them 71-59. What was it, 89? Did he get to 90 or just 89? 90. Got to 90.
And I got to say, I'm shocked. I thought they'd post 100 for sure.
There's a big block. Perry gets after it. Jesse Perry with a big block.
It's good to see Oregon getting more aggressive to start the second half, taking it strong to the hole, but Perry says, not in my house. Creates a little souvenir for the fans.
I always thought that'd be a nice touch in basketball. If you get the ball, you get the ball. Might cost a little bit. Out of two on the shot clock, high Archer is no good. Katron the rebound, and he gets inside and scores.
That's just no effort right there by Arizona. He shoots a fadeaway. He's the furthest person from the ball. Excellent hustle getting the basketball and getting the putback.
Williams kind of chicken wings around the lane, and Katron, I think, got him on the dribble drive, and it will be a foul on Jovan. And is it before the shot or after the shot? That's what they're trying to determine right now.
You see the shot right here and the follow. No one around, no one being physical, putting it right back in.
Foul before the shot, so Arizona will inbound the ball. They have a 13-point lead. Hill somehow gets it and puts it in. A great play by Hill. Sometimes the reception of the pass is overlooked, isn't it?
Yeah, it wasn't the best pass in the world. Arizona's run that play several times, and that's the first time they've ever gotten that high-low on the curl move. But it wasn't a great pass. Solomon, one of the best passers and guys with some of the best hands on the team for Arizona, able to corral it and get it up to the rim.
Oregon only had 5 turnovers in the first half. They come out with one here. Arizona had 10 turnovers. Here's Williams. Really quiet so far. Nice move. And look at that. Wow.
So sweet. He faces up like a guard, swings it through, crosses it over, and then finishes with the left. I don't know anybody that can stop that kind of play.
His first basket of the game. Jeremy Jacob. He scores. I think they just have to keep going to that over and over and over, don't they, Corey?
You've got to go at Derek Williams. That's the only way you're going to slow him down. He's not a shot blocker. He's a big man just like anybody else in the Pac-10. You've got to challenge him defensively night in and night out.
We're going to call a jump ball. Tyrone Nared working against Perry, and they'll call it jump ball, Arizona's ball.
Here you see a 6'8", 240-pound power forward stopping on a dime and then switching to the left for the finger roll. Unbelievable body control and skill. That's why you see so many players in the NBA and in college trying to play a face-up game.
Williams gets it tipped away. 5 on the shot clock. They have to get one up. Williams, I'm not sure if he realizes it. He tries to get it up. Knocked away with no time on the shot clock, so it's a shot clock violation, and it'll be Oregon basketball.
Great hands on that play defensively. Derek Williams had the mismatch. He waved everybody away and said, hey, fellas, I got this one. And just a great way to get your hand in the cookie jar and knock it loose.
Ducks trail it by 15. Remember, they came back 24 down against Missouri in the second half. Missouri, a top 10 team, and that would have been big. Armstead's going to go to the line, though.
You know, Joe, if you wrote a book on how to blow a lead, the first chapter would be send guys to the free throw line. This is a prime opportunity to cut into the lead. No time comes off the clock. Stay aggressive. Let's see if Oregon continues. It's obviously their first 3 or 4 possessions out of the timeout, out of the second half, have been to attack the basket.
Of course, if you're Oregon, the first chapter of how not to come back is miss your free throws. They're 3 of 8 from the line, Corey.
They're called free throws. They're supposed to be free.
Armstead finally gets one. He's 1 of 4 from the line tonight.
Ducks get to set that press that they love.
Armstead almost gets to it. Here's Momo Jones.
Long three from out top is good for Solomon Hill. You know, that's tough, because what you want when you press a team is you want them to take a quick shot, and Solomon Hill takes a quick shot only 6 or 7 seconds into the possession and nails it. That's just tough. You got to live with that one.
He's got 8 in the game. That's one of those, I don't know that. Okay, we'll take it.
Exactly.
Williams goes by Nared, draws the foul all the way up, and he'll go to the line and shoot a couple of shots. Long three.
That's from a different zip code right there. Solomon Hill off of the line about 2 to 3 feet, knocks it down nice and smooth.
Well, it's a great weapon to have. A lot of times when a post player can trail a break and just get an open in rhythm 3-point shot, knocked it down.
You know, it's a credit to Solomon Hill, but Arizona's done a good job of, after they beat the pressure, it's not enough that you find the open man, but you've got to go that extra step and knock down the shot. That's how you make a team call their press off and change up their defensive scheme. You got to make them pay.
Williams misses that free throw, but he's chipping away. He's 6 of 8 from the line. Armstead all the way, lays it up, and counts the basket.
Great energy right there. Taking it all the way. Armstead taking it all the way, not even seeing, you know, crossing it over, and then getting a little bit of a bump off the glass, and it's good. Attacking before Arizona even has a chance to set up.
Malcolm's first basket of the game. He's been all around the rim tonight. Got one to go that time.
J.R. Strobridge checks into the Oregon lineup.
Strobridge going to come in for Jonathan Lloyd.
Lloyd. Malcolm Armstead is alive, shooting one.
With the free throw, they can get it to 14 and kind of in that hanging around number, right?
And you set the press, which has been paid some dividends for you before.
Harum. The students right in our ears too, folks. Hill, tough drive. Cats with the rebound and the basket. Nice play by Harum.
Kevin Parham, the cleanup man. Solomon Hill turned the corner, forced it up. Kevin Parham just being down and dirty, getting in there and getting that rebound.
He's got 13 in the game. Armstead for 3. And I think he just pointed the wrong way. I think he's getting the over-the-back call. He just pointed the wrong way.
Well, you see 3 cats down there going up for the rebound. Great body control by Parham. On the other foul, you had Derek Williams coming over the top to tip the ball back out. Referee's calling for over the back.
Looked like a pretty good rebound.
Yeah.
Well, I think Oregon would have had the ball anyway. It would have tipped them. But it'll be the second foul on Williams. He's got just 2. With 16:02 to go in the basketball game. Arizona up by 16. Jacob, Ducks starting to heat up a little bit.
You know, he's by far been their most effective player so far with his percentages and his aggressiveness. I think they got to keep going to him. He's had the hot hand.
He's got 11. Cats break the press and get the foul. And that will take us to 15:39 in the basketball game. It's a 14-point game. Oregon kind of hanging around.
So we bought a house, love the kitchen, love the location.
Hated the bathroom.
Glenn 6'2", and our shower head, a whopping 5'5".
Who does that?
So we got a home equity line of credit from Oregon Community Credit Union. They had the rates we wanted and nice people to walk us through the process. 3 weeks later, we got our Glenn-sized bathroom.
For whatever comes next in life, Oregon Community Credit Union. Nice. Remarkably nice.
This Christmas, Bi-Mart and 7-Up are your party central. Enjoy great savings on the light and refreshing taste of 7-Up and assorted flavors. They're the perfect drinks at every party this season. Bi-Mart has the perfect recipe for a great party. Take one part 7-Up, a healthy dose of snacks, a splash of your favorite mixer, and just add your friends. Bi-Mart is your headquarters for party shopping with great values on plates, cups, and decorations, too. Bi-Mart and 7-Up are your party central. We're just right for a Christmas full of savings.
change.
It's nice to know you can trust people. State Farm is counting on it. They want you to talk to your neighbors, then call a State Farm agent, find out how you can get discounts up to 40%. See, State Farm insures 40 million drivers. That's more than Geico and Progressive combined. 40 million drivers, more savings, and discounts up to 40%.
So call an agent at 1-800-STATE-FARM or go online.
Tonight's game is brought to you by Bud Light. It's a sure sign of a good time. Here we go. By Bi-Mart, it's just right for the Northwest. By State Farm Insurance, proud to be your Oregon sponsor. And by Oregon Community Credit Union. Nice, remarkably nice. 46-32, let's go over to Jill Sapp. Jill?
Well, thanks, Joe. I had a chance to talk to Arizona coach Sean Miller at halftime, and he says that he was really not sure that this game is over yet. With a double-digit lead, he wasn't going to give anything away because Oregon can trap you so many different ways and give you so many different looks on the defensive end of the court. He said he was really disappointed with all of the turnovers and sloppy play there at the end of the first half, and they've got to just take care of the ball here in the second half, Joe.
All right, thanks, Jill. The 10 turnovers. It's now 11 for Arizona. He's going to demand perfection, isn't he? Kind of reminds me of another coach who's a little bit legendary in Arizona when he was starting his career.
Attention to detail, the good coaches, and, you know, both he and the coach for Oregon, they want to stress this. You've got to keep your players in a mentality where they do not slack at all.
Jeremy Jacobs is gotten a little bit hot. He's got 13 in the game. Jacob, his most extended action so far this season. Parham, down low. Oh, look out! Highlight time!
It hurts because you do a great job. You almost come up with the steal, and Kevin Parham finds Derek Williams for the highlight dunk.
Armstead draws the foul, and he'll go to the line.
Kevin Parham penetrates the whole while expecting to turn it, and there you just see why Arizona fans are so excited about Derek Williams. He's just such a gifted athlete. But more importantly, Arizona's been able to handle the pressure and get good shots, where in past games they've had pressure and not gotten good shots.
You know, Corey, he's so long that I think his foot might have been out of bounds when he caught the ball, and with just one move, he's dunking it. I mean, it's a long ways to go from the baseline to the basket.
He's got the 7-foot wingspan. He's got the good athleticism. He's calm. He's cool and collected. He knows that eventually the game's going to come his way. He just wants to be there and deliver for the Cats.
Williams is now in double figures with 10 after a quiet first half. 14-point lead. Ducks are working hard, doing a lot of chasing for Dana Altman's team. And there's the steal, Strobridge. He takes it up and scores.
This is the part of the game where you want to stay calm. You want to fight through this if you're Arizona. And if you're Oregon, you want to keep this tempo going.
For two, not there. Jacob the rebound. Ducks can cut it down to single digits with a three or get it to 10. Down by 12, plenty of time in the basketball game. They get it down low. Stigler is blocked, but he gets it back.
And that was a game changer.
Three, not there. I tell you, this place would have erupted.
The roof would come off. They wouldn't have to demolish this place. It would have came down on its own. Had Singler got that and cut it to 10. Ducks with new life here in the second half.
Long range shot is good. A big one for Nachechko.
You can't coach that. You can't scout that. Most coaches in the country will tell you. 6'10" guy out there, let him shoot it. But Kirill Nachechko has knocked that down time and time again for Arizona. Arizona penetrate. Normally you're there to pass, but Kirill says, you know what, I'm open, I'll knock it down. And Coach Miller lets him shoot that in practice, therefore he can shoot it in the game.
Not a bad time for your first basket to silence the crowd, the old silencer. 14-point game. That settled the crowd down for sure.
Jacob gets it picked.
Fogg did a nice job getting in the dribble drive, and they're collapsing on Jeremy Jacob now.
They've recognized that he is a big-time threat. He's having a heck of a game.
Ducks have 7 turnovers. Fogg, nice pick by Nijechko, and Fogg comes up short. Here comes Oregon the other way. Jonathan Lloyd. Singler, been really quiet today. Lloyd and I, little drop step, but he misses the lay-in. He gets there and can't finish.
So I don't know what else you can ask for. Beautiful screen, penetration, point-blank layup. You've got to come through with that one.
Arizona throws it away. So Catron's going to come back in for Jeremy Jacob. What a great stretch right there. Also, Malcolm Armstead will come in for Jonathan Lloyd. E.J. Singler stays in. E.J., no points yet.
He may be there. He's a shooter. You never know. If he's in his rhythm, he can knock a few down. He's just got to be more aggressive.
Hey, if you've got a group, church group or civic organization, you want to be a part of Oregon Athletics, come to a game, basketball, baseball, whatever. Go to GoDucks.com for more information. Garrett Sims scores. And I think they're going to say Nijechko was going up. It looked like he was just trying to capture it. Let's see. They'll give him 2 shots. Was he shooting?
That's a Christmas gift a few days late. He catches the ball in the post. We always assume he's going to go up. We don't know whether it was to pass or to shoot, but he does a great job of selling it to the refs.
I think, looking at it at that angle, his arms are definitely going up like he was going up for a shot. So I think it's a good call. Knocks down the free throw. Ducks are making a game of it. 53-40 with 12:05 to go. Some life in the building. Ducks have heated up shooting-wise. And Arizona's had to make some good plays to stem the tide.
You know, the good news for Oregon, they've gotten that shooting percentage up to 50% and almost 66% from 3 here in the second half. Bad news is Arizona's at 80 and they're shooting 100% from the free throw line. So,
yeah, as Oregon's elevated their game, so is Arizona. Remains a 14-point game. Strobridge, tough shot. He hits it. It's a 2.
It could be a run here by Oregon when you knock down shots like that.
How's that for a play? Ball handling in the basket. Fans don't like the call. Fogg takes it coast to coast and scores. And he'll be going to the line after the timeout. And for Jovan Catron, that is number 5. With 11:31 to go in the game, we'll take a timeout.
That's right. It's a beefy crunch burrito. And yes, it's loaded with flaming hot Fritos chips because I don't like playing it safe. I'm a wild man, but also responsible because it's just 99 cents. So why don't you turn around one more time? I dare ya. Oh boy, now what? The new 99-cent beefy crunch burrito. The crunch of flaming hot Fritos chips, seasoned beef, and nacho cheese sauce. All for just 99 cents at Taco Bell.
He's a Mac with the cheddar.
I can't get insurance.
Shibubi does it better.
EWI, SR22.
What you gonna do when they come for you?
You got bad credit and a ticket too. Time to see the Mac with the quick go-to. Roll 6 deep in a 4-seat buggy.
Wrapped up tight in a burnt box snuggie.
Burnt box snuggie. Auto home and business need. Burnt box is guaranteed. 1-800-654-7722.
When you wanna get okay.
The Fan is going live from Glendale, Arizona to cover every aspect of the national championship game between the Ducks and the Auburn Tigers. We'll take you inside the game. We'll cover key matchups, break down all the angles, and we'll talk with special guests Chip Kelly, Gene Chizik, Big Nick Fairley, LaMichael James, plus a who's who of pundits that'll be down in Arizona as well. The Fan, live from Glendale, Arizona. Action begins January 4th at 3 p.m. on Comcast Sportsnet.
It's 56-42 after Jordan Mays makes an unbelievable play. I think I might have said Fogg. It was Mays on the coast-to-coast run. Look at the ball handling. Might have got fouled there. Kept going. Draws the foul like Fletch and scores.
You know, it's kind of one of those touchy situations. The coach has a right to be upset here. He initiates the contact, but the standard rules of basketball apply. If you're moving and I'm moving, then the foul's on you. That's just a strong play by the point guard. I just don't see them calling a charge on that play.
No, he's on the side. You can't call a charge. Good play to lean into him. And Jordan Mays, I think with the play of the game for you, the place is starting to get loud. Ducks are making a run. They've gotten as close as they've been all game long. And not only that, but it sends Oregon's leading scorer to the bench with 11:28 to go with five fouls. A huge play by Jordan Mays.
Changed the game. And, you know, he hits a silencer. Nichesko hits a silencer. Arizona's been fortunate to come up with big buckets when they needed them to kind of stop this Oregon run.
Leads back to 15. Sim. Jeremy Jacob, now Singler, who has to emerge if Oregon's going to get back in this thing. There's five on the shot clock. Armstead, tough break. Singler without a point still. Ducks are 17 of 47 from the field tonight. Parham, hot early, still hot. With 10:35 to go. Another three is fourth of the game.
I think they may need to check the roof because it's raining in here. Kevin Parham has got his fourth three. And I don't know if there's anything they can do to stop the way that he's scoring because Arizona's just penetrating and rotating.
6 of 11 from three-point range. Jacob scores again. Jacob's got 15 in the game.
Jenkins has been a bright spot for Oregon. He's playing aggressive, he's fearless, he's scoring. If he had two or three other players playing alongside him, this game would be single digits for sure.
Arizona makes a wholesale substitution. This is where that depth, I mean, imagine this game against Washington now. Everybody's working so hard, the game's 60-61, let's say, and now you bring in four fresh guys for Arizona. That's why I think they're gonna win the league.
Well, that's what this, you know, you see college basketball, that 30-minute mark is so crucial in a college game. This is where a team with superior conditioning stays at that level, and teams that aren't as deep or maybe they're not in the same type of shape, they tend to fall behind. So that 10-minute mark in the second half is when you start to see some real basketball.
As it is, this one still remains in doubt. The Ducks have had a couple of little mini runs here in the second half. Trail it by 16 with 9:51 to go. They're getting enough turnovers to get back in the game. And they give it right back to them with the turnover of their own on cue.
The positive for Oregon is their offense works and their shots are there. On another night where everything's falling, this is a different type of game. You've got a young crew, a lot of transfers, a lot of walk-ons, but they're playing solid basketball, but they're just not knocking down their shots.
You know, if you shoot just 45%, it's a different game. You know, right now, where they are, you're right down about 40% for the game.
Right, absolutely. And you know, Joe, there comes a point where all this running and trapping tends to work on your legs, and that's the first thing that affects your shooting is your legs.
Ducks pick up another steal and another turnover. That's 15 turnovers for Arizona tonight. Ducks need a basket here. Jacob's been the go-to guy. Lloyd into the land of the Giants. He gets there again and can't finish. How many lay-ins has Oregon missed tonight?
Oregon has left a lot of money on the table tonight.
Williams and Armstead getting tied up.
And they're going to call a foul on Malcolm Armstead. The Cats had the advantage, not quick to recognize. You got to get it to Derek Williams. Got the point guard on him.
Now, what they're calling him for is that hook. He does a great job of getting one hand up, but that other hand hooks Derek Williams. And, I mean, he's fighting for his dear life down there on the block. Derek Williams being very patient, not doing too much to pick up the offensive foul, but definitely drawing the referee's attention to it.
They got the mismatch, and now Armstead will go to the bench. He's got four fouls in the game with 8:57, so Ducks fighting some foul trouble here. Derek Williams back to the line and misses the front end of the one-on-one. 8 of 11 from the line tonight for Williams. Ducks with a small lineup with Lloyd, DeAndre Williams, Strobridge. And this is Jeremy Jacob.
Hands up.
Makes a nice move. Perry, the rebound. On action right now, open for the three. Strobridge needs to hit it. Story of the night. Back to back. And now Momo Jones pulls it out. Gives it to Lavender. Still a 16-point game as we approach the 8-minute mark. And Jamil Horn gets up off the bench and heads to the scorer's table. They've been double-teaming Derek Williams all night. It's really been the outside shooting that's done Oregon in. Here's Hill. As you mentioned, Corey, the legs may be starting to go a little bit for both teams.
For both teams, you can't maintain this pace for 40 minutes, and now you're seeing things that are easy, like layups. Finally, one goes down, but you're seeing layups and spin moves, and things are looking a little bit off kilter. These guys are tired. That's why you see so many guys at the scorers table right now ready to check in.
Foul is on Jonathan Lloyd. 7:30 to go in the game. It's a 14-point game.
Well, for many years back, Gordon, as you know, is the entertainment
Love the kitchen, love the location.
Hated the bathroom.
Glenn 6'2", and our shower head, a whopping 5'5".
Who does that?
So we got a home equity line of credit from Oregon Community Credit Union. They had the rates we wanted and nice people to walk us through the process. 3 weeks later, we got our Glenn-sized bathroom.
For whatever comes next in life, Oregon Community Credit Union. Nice, remarkably nice.
Pepsi Max, please. Good song. Great song.
So, Pepsi Max has zero calories, huh?
Yep.
How many calories?
Zero.
Zero?
Zero.
What are you doing?
YouTube.
Huh.
Pepsi Max. Zero calories. Maximum Pepsi taste.
60-46, 7:30 to go here in Arizona's final appearance here at MacArthur Court. We've been scanning the crowd, of course, for the best smile. Every game we do this is the natural dentures smile of the game. Is that the winner? We're just going to go straight to the winner this time. Natural dentures smile of the game.
I don't think she has dentures.
She doesn't have dentures.
Just the natural
smile. What we're showing you is what, if you do have dentures, what your smile's going to look like.
There you go. I like that. I like that.
One big thing tonight, Arizona's done a good job shooting the basketball tonight. Open shots. And generally, you know, Corey, over the course of the game, they've knocked them down.
They knocked them down. They took aim, and they let them fly. I mean, a little bit of a duck hunting, duck shooting, I guess you could say. Arizona doing a great job of living from beyond the arc. Now, that's not going to be there every night. They've balanced that with some good inside play, but
Arizona probably relieved to play well against the zone for the first time in a long time this season.
They're 56% from the field, Corey, which is just a great number on the road in the conference, especially in this building. Oregon is at 36%. It's amazing the game's not even, you know, it's not more one-sided giving those shooting percentages. But turnovers is the big difference. They've given the ball up, and Oregon's crossed the turnovers with their press.
It's been turnovers, and Oregon's had a lot of missed opportunities. But when you see the way Arizona's been shooting, and you know, a lot of people see a zone. Zone defense is more difficult to play than a man-to-man because you have to guard an area, which is a lot harder than guarding and following a guy around, making sure he doesn't score. And that's what Arizona's been able to get those open shots from.
Singler misses. He's 0 for 6. From the field, a big dunk, but I think Naren blocked, I guess. I always wondered why a dunk going down and getting blocked isn't goaltending.
You know, that's the second time Solomon Hill has attacked the basket. I know Coach Miller loves to see that. Great move. He moves without the ball, takes it strong, and in his defense, he got whacked on the arm. There was no call. Solomon Hill taking it strong.
Yeah, forget the block situation. Naren didn't get there.
You know, you give me a sophomore that's 6'7", 220 pounds, is going to move without the ball and try to dunk. You can't complain about that.
Singler, his first two of the game, makes it a 13-point game.
Mr. Singler, where have you been? Guys have been needing him for most of the game. There you see the turnover with that pressure defense.
They're still in the game, Corey. You know, every time Arizona's tried to make it a 22 or 24 and lay the hammer down, Oregon's made a play to stay in it.
That's a great play, a ball fake. You know, not having the hops, going ahead and getting the guys in the air. Defensive errors and offensive errors. That's two back-to-back bad plays by Arizona. You've got both guys leaving their feet, and then you've got the reaction to the pressure, trying to beat the press, going a little bit faster than you should. Kevin Parham steps out of bounds.
Keandre Williams with the bad luck. Miss as it hits off the back of the rim. A lot of lay-ins tonight that they've missed.
You know, Joe, with 6 minutes to go, Oregon's going to need a few things to go right to tighten this game up.
Horn with plenty of time. And a foul called on Oregon, I believe. I'm not sure yet. They haven't really made it clear. It's going to be on Naren. Now the crowd hears that they don't like it.
Well, the crowd obviously doesn't see what the referees see. You see Kirill Nechesko in perfect position, being held down with the offhand and still managing to get his other hand up to the ball. It's a tough call to make because it really doesn't affect the game at all, but you got to call that.
Free throw is good. I don't know that he missed today in the shoot-around, Corey, watching him shoot the basketball. He just, you know, a lot of the European players, they start with the outside shot. What do they do, play horse all the time?
Well, what they do, you know, I played 12 years in Europe, and the one thing I noticed right away from a very young age, the coaches do not discriminate between big men and guards. When they come out and do ball handling, all 15 kids do ball handling. They all do shooting. They all do three. And that's why you see Dirk Nowitzki, Tony Kukoc, all the European players with height still being good players.
15-point game. 6:04 to go here at MacArthur Court.
The Extreme Makeover people called us a couple weeks ago and asked if we could help out with the construction of the Oregon School for the Deaf. Guaranteed loan 13 RVs to house the important construction and supervisory people on site. And even Ty Pennington came out and welcomed Guaranteed's group for contributing to the effort. It really feels good to have play a small part in the Extreme Makeover show, helping build the new School for the Deaf here in Oregon. And all we could suggest to our fellow business people and citizens is to help a neighbor when you can.
Hey, it's Isaac Gropp from The Fan. Did you know that every family in our community who has a child with a life-threatening illness is touched by the Children's Cancer Association? Last year, 3,000 families. When these kids need more than medicine, the CCA is there, but they need your support now. We at The Fan have teamed with the CCA to raffle off two VIP passes to the 2011 Masters, the toughest ticket in sports. $7,000 value, raffle tickets, $40. Buy as many as you can and support critically ill children.
Comcast SportsNet, home of the Trailblazers.
Trailblazers Courtside will bring you the most in-depth Trailblazers coverage around.
Rip City Live, a Blazer pregame show before every home game.
Rip City, baby.
Talking ball, a round table discussion after every Blazers game.
Catch all 60 games in HD.
LaMarcus right side jams.
Comcast Sportsnet, home of the Portland Trailblazers. Game on.
Become a fan of the Cats on Facebook. Join the thousands of Wildcat fans who are fans of the official Facebook page of the Arizona Wildcats. Get behind-the-scenes information, special contests, prizes, and event updates by visiting facebook.com/Arizona Athletics. Or when you log into Facebook, just search Arizona Athletics and become a fan.
6:04 to go, and for all you Duck fans out there, go to Facebook and search Oregon Athletics. And our Facebook page in Oregon has gone from 54,000 before the football season started to 178,000 fans in 3.5 months of this football season. It's been incredible. Jeremy Jacob. Oh, I don't know who gets credit. Lachetko, I think.
I said it before, a couple of things are going to have to go right for Oregon to work their way back into this game, and the mystery tip-in was one of them.
One thing we love to use the Facebook page for is to give people benefits. Get things, money off, prizes, and you can get it all the way down and into the lane with a nice-looking lay-in is Kevin Parham, who's having a night.
He's had the answer all night for Arizona. Every time Oregon was in sniffing distance of making some things happen, Kevin Parham's closed that door.
He's got 18 on the night on 7 of 8 shooting, and the Ducks turn the ball over. Not sure who got this ball in. I guess you're going to give it to E.J. Singler.
Got to give it to him. He's closest man to it when it goes in. And he does get his hand on it and push it back towards the rim. So great effort there by Singler.
15-point lead for Arizona with 5 minutes to go in the basketball game. Mays. Hayes just makes everything look easy, doesn't he? Float around.
He's
kind of like Brandon Jennings, isn't he?
Exactly. So relaxed. He has great poise. You know, you want him to be intense, but that's just not his personality. He gets his results.
Didn't want to bring up a sore subject about Brandon Jennings, but he plays the game a lot like Brandon did when he was in high school. The foul's going to be on Jeremy Jacob. And it feels a little bit like Oregon had maybe their last gasp as they did a good job keeping the game relatively close, Corey, but, you know, the team with a lot of great talents and depth tonight looks like they're going to get out of here with a win.
Yeah, you've only got so much gas in your tank, and the amount of energy that it takes to fight back and cut into a 15-point lead, if you do get it cut down, you don't have anything left. However, Kevin Parham has a whole lot left, and he's just cutting them to pieces here in the second half.
He's got 20. Strobridge for three. That makes Oregon 1 of 15 from three-point range. And, you know, I don't even know that it's the three-point shooting, even as bad as it was at 1 for 15 from three-point range. I think it's more the missed lay-ins, Corey. They had their chances.
They have had point-blank layups. They've done a great job of handling Arizona's defensive pressure. They've gotten to the basket. And if there's anything Coach Miller's going to look at, you know, in between this game and the Oregon State game, he's going to be looking at how many opportunities were not cashed in, because you can't give solid teams these looks on a different night. Oregon knocks these down, they may be leading the game.
Malcolm Armstead fouls out with 6 points in the game. So Armstead and Kitron are on the bench with 4:16 to go. And the lead is as big as it's been here with a 19-point advantage, and Fogg trying to make it 20. And you can see, Corey, how this Oregon team is going to win a few games.
They definitely will win a few games, because you will not shoot 29% every night out. There will be nights where you catch fire, and these guys are very tenacious. They play solid D, and they create turnovers.
Yeah, I think defensively, you know, Arizona shot the ball pretty well tonight, but it wasn't easy. They didn't make it easy on them when Arizona was on offense. I think Parham just shot lights out early. They got to the basket. Their muscle under the basket got them a few easy ones late in the game, but they turned the ball over a little bit, too. It wasn't easy on them.
Very balanced attack for Arizona. And Oregon as well. Oregon, I thought, went to the outside shot way too often, way too early. As you see Kyle Fogg pull up off the dribble. I think Oregon should have gone to the penetrations and post-ups, because Jacobs played well, and they never really went to it.
Arizona finally puts the hammer down with a 12-4 run with 3:30 to go in the game. And a foul over the top there. on Kyle Fogg. Arizona's going to get their first Pac-10 victory of many this upcoming season here in Eugene.
This program on Comcast Sportsnet is brought to you by Standard TV and Appliance. We set the standard.
You want to spend time on what really matters. When you shop, you want to talk with an expert you can trust. And what matters to you is going to one store and finding exactly what you need. Come to the one place that has it all. Standard TV and Appliance. Expert salespeople, the best products, the largest selection, low prices, and of course, service you can depend on. Visit any of Standard's showrooms to find top name brand appliances, electronics, mattresses, and more. Standard TV and Appliance.
Tomorrow on Comcast Sportsnet.
Brought to you by American Family Insurance. Visit AmFam.com or call 1-800-MY-AmFam today. By the Neurospine Institute, surgical specialist of the spine. And by U.S. Bank. They're proud to support Oregon men's basketball. 72-50 here at MacArthur Court. The final time you'll ever see this live on television. Let's go over to Jill Savage. Jill.
Thank you, Joe. I'm joined with Lynn Chase, who was the facilities manager here at Mac Court for a very long time. What comes to mind when you think of Mac Court?
Well, it's just been a part of my life for so many years. It's just a great place to work at.
What were some of your favorite things working here in the building?
Oh, I just think I just enjoyed all the basketball games that I've had. I got the opportunity to work here, and a lot of the exciting games.
And what does it mean to you that Mac Court will close its doors after the Arizona State game?
I'm not sure how I'm going to act. Hopefully I'll be strong and everything, but it's going to be emotional, I think.
All right, thanks, Lynn. Now, Joe, back to you.
All right, thanks very much, Jill. Lynn's done a great job here in this building. It's got to be one of the toughest jobs in America to keep this thing running. It was built in 1926. So, and I know from being in here, you know, the number of dead flies that have fallen on the floor is in the hundreds of thousands. The number of rats and mice that you have to keep at bay is
wildlife.
Similar. We were in here one year where there was a bat that flew around the scoreboard over and over, and we'd play games, and you'd look up, and the bat was just going around because they would eat the flies that were up there. So there were bats and rats and vermin everywhere.
A whole ecosystem.
It certainly was, but also lots of great moments, great basketball, great crowds, great events. You know, Elvis played here, Bob Hope, John Kennedy gave a political speech here, Johnny Cash, the true champions, the big names, the Louis Armstrongs, the Nat King Cole, Jimmy Buffett, all the Oregon basketball years, the Tall Furs who won the very first NCAA championship in 1939, the Pac-10 champions of 2002, Luke Ridenour and Luke Jackson, where they won every game at home that year, only done twice in the history of the building.
Tremendous legacy here, MacArthur Court.
Time now for today's Comcast trivia question, brought to you by our friends at Comcast. All-time leading scorer in Pac-10 history.
Jesse Perry, shooting two.
The answer? Don McLean from UCLA. Comcast trivia, brought to you by our friends at Comcast, Xfinity and more. And this is a very special man here. This is Admiral John Dick. He was a member of that national championship team in 1939. He's still coming to a lot of games. He was a war hero in World War II, one of the most known people in the Eugene area and in the state of Oregon. Played in this building as a college student, and here he is today to witness the final two games in MacArthur Court. Admiral John Dick, one of the players from the 1939 championship team. What a life he's led.
That is legendary right there.
A great Duck.
maybe the greatest duck of all time, and a loyal fan of the football program, the new baseball program here, which is ranked ninth in the country in the preseason poll in their third year. Admiral Dick goes to those games as well. Track and field program that's won so many national championships. Jonathan Lloyd gets in there, and another lay-in not there. And Nicholas Fern is blocked hard under the basket.
You know, with the game in hand, you look at the lineup that Oregon has out there. These guys are hustling, getting offensive rebounds, staying with it, being positive. And you love to see that because it is such a long season. You don't want anybody hanging their heads and not giving 100% effort. So you want to definitely applaud these guys for coming in and playing strong.
Some things to take away from this game for Oregon, for sure. I think they had their chances. They had shots, Corey. They were able to force enough turnovers to win a game. They just couldn't shoot the basketball. And then Arizona just with too much talent. If you're Arizona, what do you take away from this game now as you look forward to the Oregon State game?
Well, you know how good you can be when you stick to your game plan. And you've already been in a hostile environment where a team made a run and you sustained it. So right now it's about character building. You've got 9 road games in the Pac-10. Well, one of them's down. You got 8 more go. So do you build your character as a team and get stronger? You got to have some battle scars in the Pac-10. You got to get tougher every time you go out. And I think Arizona can say we played a tough arena, one of the toughest places in the country to play. We played a scrappy team and we held it together.
Have you formulated kind of a look at the conference in general and seen the other teams play? How you feel it might turn out?
I think that, you know, Washington will defend their home court, but I just see those guards not being able to night in and night out deliver. I think the Pac-10 champion will have 3, maybe 4 losses for sure. So given that formula, Arizona could go through and lose 3 or 4. Washington certainly could. I think UCLA would most definitely lose 3 or 4. So I really see a logjam at the 1 through 3. I don't know who it could be.
You know, in a lot of years, the championship hasn't mattered all that much. You know, Corey, the year that Arizona won the national championship, I believe they finished 4th in the league.
Right.
You know, this year, you have to finish 1st or 2nd. And 1st is so much more important because only the Pac-10 champion is staying in the West. The way the RPIs are right now, it's hard to see the 2nd team staying in the West. And so you need to win the league. It's important this year to win the league and to have the highest RPI so you can stay out West in the first round of the NCAA tournament. And again, I don't think there's anybody out there that thinks the Pac-10 at the most is getting more than 3 teams in the tournament. And most experts think it's going to be 2 like it was last year.
Yeah, 3 is a wish. 2 is probably the reality. But, you know, you're going to get what you can take. You know, north, south, east, west, just get in the tournament, you know?
It makes you think that Cal, the defending conference champion, or USC, that's looked very good, or UCLA with a lot of talent, you know, or Arizona or Washington, you know, 3 of those teams might not go. 2 of them, I think, for sure are not going to be in the tournament. Lloyd all the way, uses his body, and that one falls, and it'll go to the line. With 36 seconds to go.
Great move. Did the same thing Mays did earlier. You go full speed, 100 miles an hour. You get a big man on you, and you slam on the brakes, and you let him hit you in the back while you're going up for the 2.
Needed it to happen a little earlier.
Yeah. You know, for Oregon, it's just, you know, I call it a bad day at the office. You know, the only problem is your office seats 9,000 people who all got to watch it. You got to just really focus on the good stuff and take away what you can. You had the open opportunities, some bad bounces, and you had some good bounces tonight, too.
Ducks are going to be below 40% for the game, right in that area. And Arizona over 50 for the game. So they've done a nice job shooting it, and they can just dribble it out here and end this thing and get on to Corvallis and hang out in the cold air for a few days and get ready for the Beavers at Gill Coliseum. And they're on their way, Sean Miller, and a little reuniting of the coaches from the Midwest who have made it out to the West Coast. Arizona with a hard-fought win. They win the game by 19, but they had to work at it for sure. Oregon didn't give it to them. Arizona earned it here tonight against the Oregon Ducks. They played really good defense, I thought, Corey. Really good defense, and they just shot lights out.
They shot lights out, and everybody got involved, from Kevin Parham to Derek Williams to Momo Jones, Kyle Fogg. They spread it around really good. No, the balanced attack, they're going to be, like you said, one of the tougher teams in the Pac-10 to beat this year.
So Arizona
goes to 1-0 here in the Pac-10. Oregon will regroup and face Arizona State here on Saturday night in the final game, final men's basketball game in MacArthur Court before the move to the new Matthew Knight Arena. And this is your final look here on TV of this incredible place. We'll wrap it up after this.